to Easy LM, Learning Simplified. My name is Ruth, and today we are going to be learning on Form 2 Mathematics, and our topic for today is Statistics, and our subtopic is Histograms. So we have been discussing how to represent data on various forms of representation. So today we are going to see how to represent given data on an histogram. So let's get into it. So histograms usually use frequency as one of the components when it comes to drawing the histograms. So the frequency in each class is represented by a rectangular bar whose area is proportional to the frequency, where the bars are of the same width and the height of the rectangle is proportional to the frequency. So in histograms, we usually use bars, and these bars can be, they're of the same width and height. Sometimes they will be on the same width, other times it may not have equal class boundaries. So in the case where it will not be equal, then we'll use a different formula. I will show you that in a minute. So the bars are usually joined together, unlike the bar graph where the bars are separated, and the class boundaries mark the boundaries of the rectangular bars in histogram. So we will be using the upper limits and the lower limits in the histograms. So you've been given a specific class boundary, but you use the limits when you come to drawing. So this is an example. So this is a regular histogram. You can see the class width or the class intervals are uniform throughout. That is the reason why the width of the rectangular bars are equal, but you can see their frequencies are different. So when they are equal, you just use the frequency as it is. So let's look at one example where we have equal class intervals. So this is a question. The marks scored by 200 from four students in a school were recorded in the table below. So we have 41 to 50, 50 to 55, 56 to 65, 66 to 70, 71 to 85. So we have the frequencies. So on the graph, the paper provided, do a histogram to represent this information. So the first thing that we need to do is to ensure that the class width is equal throughout, because if it's not equal, then we have to use frequency density. So let's confirm that. So 50 minus 41 will give us 9. And then 55 minus 51 will give us 4. So you notice that it's not equal across. So let's look at what we are going to draw this table one more time here, and then we are going to calculate show the upper limits and the lower limits, and then we calculate the class width, and then we calculate the frequency density, because you notice they are not equal throughout. So we have the upper limit and the lower limit shown. So I've already indicated. So you can see like the 41 to 50. So we use the lower limit, which is 40.5, and the upper limit, which is 50.5. And then for the 51 and 55, it becomes 50.5 and then 55.5. So let's look at the width. And we get the width so that we can be able to see if they are equal or not, which we concluded they are not. But let's get now the specific width, because you use it for getting the frequency density. So 50.5 minus 40.5 will give us a width of 10. And then 55.5 minus 50.5 will give us a width of 5. And then 65.5 minus 55.5 will give us a width of 10. And then 70.5 minus 65.5 will give us a width of 5. And finally, 85.5 minus 70.5 will give us a width of 15. So you see there is a very big difference. They are not equal. So we cannot directly draw these frequencies in the a graph that we have on the x-axis and y-axis. If they were equal, you just go ahead and draw them at the frequency as it is in the x-axis and y-axis. So what you are going to use today is frequency, density, and that is what we are going to indicate on the y-axis or on our Cartesian plane. So frequency density is calculated by getting the frequency over the class width. So when you go to the upper limit, lower limit, or the class interval of the first max, that is 40.5 to 50.5, the frequency was 21. So it's going to be 21 over the class width we have said is 10. So this is going to be 2.1. Same applies, the frequency for the second class interval is 5 over the frequency which was given in the table is 62. So this is going to be 5 divided by 62, which will give us 62 over 5. Let's correct that. This will give us 12.4. And then we have next between 55.5 and 65.5 was 55. So we are going to divide this with the class interval, which is 10, which will give us 5.5. And then 65 to 70.5, we have been given 50, and the class width is 5, which is going to give us 50 divided by 5, which is going to give us 10. And finally, we have 70.5 to 85.5, and the frequency that you were given was 12, but the class width is 15. So this is going to be 12 divided by 15, which will give us 0.8. So these are the values we are going to use for our y-axis instead of the frequencies that we were initially given. And I say the reason why we do that is because the class width is not uniform throughout. So when you draw our x-axis and the y-axis, this is going to be frequency density. And then this is going to be our class limits. That is for the upper limits and the lower limits. You'll notice that you're going to be using the lower limit throughout. So I'm going to call this the class interval. Or you can go ahead and call them the max. So we are going to use the lower limits, that is 40.5, 50.5, 60.5, 70.5. So we are going to use a different scale so that we can be able to have a bigger diagram. So we use the scale of 2 centimeters represents 10. So this is going to be 50.5 and then 60.5 and 70.5, 80.5, so that you can have 85.5 here. So this is the x-axis. On the y-axis, we have our highest value on the y-axis is going to be 12. And you notice we have approximately 1, 2, 3, 4, 6, 7, 8, 9, 9 squares. So that means that we are going to have so if you do 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, it may not be able to accommodate everything. So you can use 2, 4, 6, and so on and so forth. So 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, and then 12, and then we have 14, so that at least our graph is enough to accommodate all the values. So if one small square represents 2, the frequency density of 2, and we have five small squares, it means one small square represents 0.4. So keep that in mind. So the first, the between 40.5 and 50.5, we have a width of 2.1. So let's go up. So 2.1, so 2 is here. Remember we said 1 small square is 0.4. So 2.4, 2.8, and then 3. And then 3.4. So 2.4, 2.8, 3.2. So we need 2.1. So it's going to be here, approximately just below here. And then you complete your bar. And then for the second one is going to be 12.4, and it's going to be the class limit is between 50.5 and 55. So here, and it's 12.4. So this is going to be directly here. So you draw the rectangle for that, or the bar for that. Use a ruler. And then we have, so now the next one is going to be from 55.5 to 65.5 here. So the frequency is 5.5. So we have 4.4, and then 4.8. So 5 is going to be here. You can use a ruler. And we have next is going to be from 65.5 to 70.5. So this small one. And the frequency is going to be 10. Remember, it's here, 10. So 10 is up here. So you complete the bar. And then finally, we have from 70.5 to 85.5, and the frequency is 0.8. So this is 0.4, 0.8 is going to be here. And that's how we draw an histogram when you have an equal class intervals. So I hope you have been able to see how we draw that. As for the regular histogram, if the class intervals are equal, you just use the frequency as they are. You do not need to calculate the frequency densities, you just use as they are. So watch out for more notes and revision questions in the app on the same. So practice more and more in drawing these histograms, especially the ones that have an equal class intervals, so that you can be able to see, because they're usually tested so much more. So see you in the next lesson.